This is a production of Cornell University.
So without further ado, let's welcome Dave Mortensen. Dave.
Thank you for the nice warm welcome and the very nice attendance today. It's a real pleasure for me. It's the first time I've had the opportunity to speak at Cornell. I'm a New Yorker. And a long time ago, I actually applied to study graduate school here. I also have relatives in Ithaca, so it's really nice to be here amongst colleague friends and former students of mine. So it's just a joy for me to be here. I'm just back on the heels of a sabbatical leave, so getting back into the groove down at Penn State, and the seminar that I put together today tells a story about some things that I've been engaged in over the last 10 years or so from a pest management point of view. And I sort of have woven several pieces of that story together in a way that I hope will be interesting for you. We had a really stimulating discussion yesterday morning for 2 hours about ecological sustainable intensification. And this is something I've been thinking a lot about on the heels of a paper that we had come out last week in Bioscience, where we have been sort of stepping back and asking questions about what we're assuming about intensification. For about a month of time that I spent in Wageningen in September, I was intrigued with the notion that the Dutch use for describing an agricultural system that is kind of entrenched or locked in. And it struck me that the system that I've been working in is very much locked in. And I'll tell you about what locked in means and what the consequences of lock-in are with respect to pest management. And then sometimes when I've given this seminar, I've had folks come up to me and say, "That was rather dark." In fact, I was invited to speak in Lyon when I was in Europe in September, and I had several young people come up and say, "Wow, that was kind of dark. The lock-in part was dark." And so I've added a third piece to this, which is a bright third. And I will try to convey, actually, my enthusiasm about the path forward and the brightness that I see on that path. So the paper that I referred to, one of the bright young minds in my lab, Mitch Hunter, took the lead on this. This is a subject that we started about 4 years ago in discussion in our lab group, and it kind of took about 2 years to become clear what we were actually discussing and debating in the lab. And we took a critical look at, we didn't run the models, but we were actually assessing model output of this mantra that we've been hearing really for about the last 10 years. It's been adopted as the argument by the Agronomy Society of America. You will see it as soon as you open the splash page of Monsanto's website and lots of other places that are talking about ag production, that we need to double yield by 2050. We took the assumption then, and I feel quite strongly that this is an implied assumption, is that we must ramp up intensification of production to meet this doubling goal. Well, if you take a critical look at the doubling data, it's actually not doubling. It's more like somewhere between 30 and 50 or so percent increases in yield from today going forward to 2050. And we would argue strongly that it will not require intensification to pull this off. And this is not even looking at, in this great discussion, there were really thoughtful comments and questions and observations, and in the the Cornell Political Forum that I spoke in on Tuesday evening, all undergraduate students, really thoughtful comments about waste, food waste, thoughtful comments about human diet. None of that's even touched in this paper. We're just simply saying, what is the food demand from here going forward, and it's being overstated. That's not to say that food production doesn't need to increase, so don't, and we got a lot of blowback on this the day the paper came out on Wednesday of last week about that. We're not saying that, but we're saying it's not the increase that people have been sort of basing assumptions on. We've probably all seen these beautiful graphics of Jonathan Foley's from the Science paper, and you'll see several floral plots or spider plots in the presentation from some of the data that we've been collecting. And in the Cultivated Planet papers of Jonathan's and other papers, he argues that it's going to be important for agriculture. So here is a natural system, long flower petals, lots of ecosystem services provided. Water quality regulation, water flow, preserving habitats for biodiversity, et cetera. He argues that in the most extreme case, intensification focuses almost exclusively on production. We maximize the floral plot on production, and we're not paying attention to the other ecosystem services, not near enough attention to the other ecosystem services. And what he argues then is that, I keep going to that screen, but he argues that we need to be paying attention to a fuller suite of these services as we go forward. And that's more or less what we're arguing in this bioscience paper as well. This argument of Foley's, I would argue, really needs to be conceived of with the backdrop of the reality of what intensification looks like. I worked out in Nebraska for 15 years before coming back east. But we have this kind of large agriculture down in Lancaster County in Pennsylvania, but in the Midwest for sure it's like this. And so it's what we think of then as a suite of things. And if you could imagine this, we spent the better part of 3 hours in Wageningen one morning debating whether it's a syndrome, which has a negative connotation, or it's a cluster of things. But basically, they go together. That's the point. Larger fields, reduced crop diversity, larger farms, increased reliance on pesticides and fertilizers, increased reliance on genetically modified crops, fewer people, depopulation in rural communities is a syndrome. I kind of like syndrome, but I don't really necessarily mean that it has to be negative. I guess I don't know that I think of syndrome as such a negative term, but anyway, clusters, whatever we want to call them. So Tony and I and Chuck and other folks that do pest management, where we spend a lot of time with weedy plants, over the last 20 or so years, maybe 25, have watched something unfold. And that is the advent of herbicide-resistant crops. We heard about them coming in the mid-80s. And the first ones were commercialized in 1996. Glyphosate Roundup Ready crops came on the scene. Soybeans was the first one, then corn, then cotton. And it's interesting, you go back to the literature, we won't spend a lot of time on this, but the literature is replete with we will significantly reduce pesticide use, and in fact, actually, there are some things that we'll talk about eliminating pesticide use because the herbicide is so effective that within 2 or 3 years, the populations will have declined to a point where we would have no weed infestations in corn and soybean. And there are actually citations claiming this. When the first plants evolved resistance to this practice, which started to appear in 1999 and 2000, so 3 years after the commercialization. And that's after papers had been written and published in peer-reviewed literature in 1997 that claimed it was very hard to conceive of any plants evolving resistance to this herbicide, given how hard it was to transform the soybean and corn to be resistant to glyphosate. But when the first species were observed, people said that that's a kind of a biological curiosity. It's not economically important. We can manage for it. Today we have 28 species resistant, infesting 24 million hectares of arable cropland in the United States. And depending on which grant panel you work with, and I had the good fortune of chairing one recently in DC in January, some of our whole research programs have been co-opted to address the resistance problem that has been created by this, this management breakdown. Not surprisingly, the herbicides that the crop plants, are selected to be resistant to, the use of those have increased dramatically, right? The light blue is glyphosate use on this axis, and the dark blue is the adoption curve of the crop. So it's, and that's, we all know that, right? 90 plus percent of the acres are being planted in soybean in this crop. And this is interesting because this is something that some people would claim there's a debate about. But the facts actually are very clear. Pesticide use, which when we're thinking pesticides, insecticides, fungicides, herbicides are pesticides. Pesticide use has increased by about 110 million pounds of active ingredient in the time since genetically modified crops were introduced. And all of that increase is coming on the backs of weed pest management, with about a 20 million pound reduction in insecticide use of synthetic insecticides applied. Colleagues of mine in entomology at Penn State, Maggie Douglas has done some amazing work on this, and John Tucker, have been looking at the toxicity profile of the insecticide use pattern. And in fact, given the seed treatments that are being used, and depending on the target organism, in their case, they're looking very closely at bees and wild pollinators, the toxicity profile of insecticides has increased by about half, again, what it was pre-GMO for the pollinator community, because of the neonicotinoid insecticide use in soybean and corn in particular. So this is all a package that goes together. We engineer the crop plant to be resistant to the herbicide. Almost always it has BT traits in it as well for insect tolerance or resistance. And then the seeds are coated with a seed treatment for with fungicides and insecticides, usually three to five compounds. We've got the resistance cranking along. So this is, you can see why people say this is dark, right? I can tell a dark story, but it does get bright here in a minute. Resistance, and Tony was saying that I have entered into talking about the science in Washington, D.C., and I have done things like congressional testimony, I think something like 10 congressional briefings, meetings with the Secretary of Agriculture and the head of the EPA on this issue over the last 3 or 4 years, because one of the solutions to this problem, the agroecologists in the room are thinking, gosh, there's all sorts of things that we could be doing to address this problem. But from the private sector interest, the way to address this problem, or the way that was explored, is to insert additional genes into the crop genome that confer resistance to other herbicide active ingredients, while also keeping the glyphosate gene in the crop. So you would continue to use glyphosate And then you would use other herbicides to pick up the resistant ones and clean up the weed problem. In a 2012 paper that your own Matt Ryan and I and several other folks wrote, our so-called critical juncture paper, we were looking at these herbicide use trends. This is total herbicide use, and we were doing a lot of our work. This was also a lab discussion thing that evolved into a paper. So this is 2012 when our paper came out, but we basically really didn't have any data here. During the Bush administration, we stopped collecting herbicide use data for about 6 years, and so there's a gap in data there. And it's interesting, actually, if we were to go back and revise this, we now have some data that Maggie Douglas was able to dig out of these data files that the NRCS collects. But in any case, and then if we put the genes for these other herbicides into the crop genome, what we were predicting was going to happen is that total herbicide use and then use of other herbicides was going to increase a lot, and we were very conservative on the low end, and then we were projecting kind of a high end adoption of these herbicides, and then the total herbicide use would be heading up. You saw from Maggie's data, she already has us up through 2014, where this line is actually something up here, and that's real data since our paper came out. So a dramatic increase in herbicide use. 70% of the pesticides used in commodity crop production are herbicides. So a dramatic increase in the use of these things is a big number. And it's cause for concern. So we argue that the critical juncture then was, let's really step back and think about whether we want to be doing this stacked trait, multiple trait herbicide resistance business that we then said we'll create this herbicide slash transgene facilitated herbicide treadmill. Or we go off with some other more integrated ecological approach. And I'm going to get to the bright spot in just a minute where I'm going to say that we're doing these things, but I will say on the dark spot side, EPA and USDA decided to deregulate and allow these stack trait things to go ahead. So this has happened in the last year. And this has been a source of great frustration to me personally that we weren't able to make a more compelling argument not to do that. And why should we care? Here's my version of a flower pot plot. Another group discussion paper. So imagine in Foley's picture, so we call it a spider plot, looks like a spider web. Jonathan's are flower plots, but it's basically the length of the vector that matters. In this case, this spider plot is arguing that glyphosate, if glyphosate is at the middle of the spider plot, in other words, these other new herbicides are going to be compared to glyphosate and their toxicity increases as you go out on the vector. So if they were all equal toxicological profiles to glyphosate, they would remain in the center. If they're bigger than that, they have a bigger toxicological effect. So here's 2,4-D, that's one that the gene we're putting in. And here's dicamba. And you can see what the projected toxicological impact, for example, of using 2,4-D would be in the environment with these indicators of ecosystem health, avian diet. These are all ecotox profile data taken out of the herbicide tech reports. Okay, so the point is that these things are active, and they're active in ways that we would rather not use them. And interestingly, if you go back to some of the papers in the mid 90s, it's rather circular and disturbing. The argument for glyphosate-resistant crops was that we would not be using 2,4-D dicamba and trialate anymore. That was one of the driving arguments for the deregulation of glyphosate crops. And now There's a paper in Science in 2007, the title of which read, "Dicamba Resistance Will Preserve Biotechnology Weed Management." Fascinating. Fascinating argument. And so at the Student Political Union the other night, the students were asking, they were just asking to see, but we weren't looking at slides, so we were talking. What are some of the reasons why we would care that pesticide use would increase in a dramatic way? It turns out there's a guy, Jack Barbash, who works with the USGS, and he's one of the guys overseeing the National Water Sample Collection database nationally. And Jack said that, you should go look at some of my papers because that's the argument from my point of view why you're concerned about using more active ingredient in the environment. And the reason, he says, is that when we use more things over a larger area, the likelihood that we see it popping up in water samples, popping up in reservoir grabs, popping up in other places increases by a functional relationship that is tied to the nature, the biochemical degradation pathways, et cetera, of the herbicide active ingredients or insecticides or anything else. And so he would argue, that's the argument, right? So you have the potential then for increased exposure. At the same time, one of your classmates and his advisor I see is here, Franklin Egan, was doing some really cool work where we were asking, so that's Jack Barbash is saying it increases the likelihood that the herbicides wind up in the water. We were interested in asking the question, what happens when the increased likelihood of the herbicide lands in the field edge on flowering plants? And Franklin spent 5 years of time doing empirical studies as well as modeling, looking at the impact of very low level drift rates of these herbicides into the floral community and the potential knock-on effects to insect visitation. And not surprisingly, this is just one of the graphics from that work, but the broadleaf cover drops. The floral area drops as a function of the exposure that's occurring in the edge. And this is ironic to me because we were invited to come to the President's National Bee Summit a couple of years ago that we went down there for this to, like, all about plantings to enhance pollinators. And we were in the midst of making this decision about deregulation. And I said, gosh, if we would not do the 2,4-D dicamba thing, from a sensitivity analysis point of view, like, what are the hammers that are going to be bigger? Let's not do this stuff. And as opposed to paying farmers to plant little strips here and there, this could be happening on every soybean field and every soybean field edge. So I was thinking, let's sort of make sensible decisions here. Another student, Nelson DeBarros, fashioned a field edge plant garden after some of Anna Fiedler and Doug Landis's work in Michigan State University, where Nelson was very interested in who goes to which of these plants in the field edge from a beneficial insect's point of view. And we don't need to make a great deal of sense of this graphic, but this is a bipartite network with wild bees on the right and field edge plants on the left. The larger, the taller the box for bombus impatiens, the more bombus there were, more bombus than bombus bimaculatus. And then you can map, where did the bombus go? They went to New England aster, and they went to this, and they went to that. And you can start to understand which of these species are playing a greater or smaller role in provisioning insects in the landscape. We can then take plants out of the network, that network graphic. So here's, this is Eupatorium perfoliatum, and here's Eupatorium perfoliatum. It's a big box, it's important, supports lots of pollinators. So Eric Bonenblust and Franklin then took Eupatorium perfoliatum, and then we started stressing it with drift level doses of the herbicide. And initially, Eric was looking at floral area, and it declines as the rate increases. But interestingly, so too does visitation by the bees, and not surprisingly, you reduce the floral area, the visitation drops off, both from a floral area, and Eric and Anthony Vaudo have been measuring a decline in the quality of the food from those plants, as well as the quantity. Okay, so we went ahead with the deregulation. I'm sorry about that. New York has been very picky, actually, so there are state-level approvals of the dicamba label to be used at the state level. New York has been one of the more sticky actors in allowing it to be done here. Pennsylvania just approved it recently to be used for this summer. But again, this is frustrating to me. So here comes the bright spot. And I really am excited about this. And we certainly could spend hours on the bright spot. But I'm going to just talk about one thing. I'm going to focus on one thing. I wanted to just take a case. So 16 years I've been at Penn State. And I am not going to claim that I had anything but just the smallest little dip to do with this, because I've been working with cover crops along with so many other people. But when I drove down to Washington, D.C. last week to finish up some panel work, and I saw 40% of the fields covered in green cover crops on my drive down through Maryland and southern PA, that warms your heart. That same drive 16 years ago, I think you might have seen a field here and there lit up with cereal rye and clovers. This is new and this is exciting. Patterns of adoption. So I just wanted to just say a couple of things about patterns of adoption, because this is weed control. This is an either alternative to what we just saw in the dark spot, or some sort of important supplementation to the dark spot to help make this patched over some, in my way of thinking. I remember doing the congressional testimony, and people were really intense. Cover crops won't work, they said, in 2011. Cover crops wouldn't work, and they certainly won't help with the resistance problem. We have now data, well, we knew cover crops worked, so I just said, well, just talk to some of the farmers, they're doing it already, so we know it's working. Where does it work, where does it fit? But we also now have some cool data on the resistance things that a number of labs have been working on. And the other thing that I am really excited about is, so we can have one model of a company that's pushing through with this dicamba trait or the 2,4-D trait, and then we have this package thing with the seed and the inputs. The antithesis of that, to me, is a farmer-facilitated network of learning where the farmers are sharing knowledge with each other about practices that work for them, that are adapted to their local space. And I'll say just a very brief bit about that, keeping an eye on the time here. So one of the students, and there have been many of these studies done, but Abby Hamilton just finished doing a survey. New York is at 10% cover crop adoption, Pennsylvania 17%, Maryland 27%, Delaware 26% adoption, Iowa 1.3% adoption, Michigan 7% adoption. We got a long ways to go. But the Northeast is making really good progress here. New York, 10%. You got your challenges, but I mean, that's cool. 17%, 27% in states that have environmental market payment incentives to do the practice. Environmental market payment incentives work. Tax and spend liberal, right? What is it? Let's build it into the farm bill and let's get it going here. This is pest management. This is multifunctional agriculture. Very quickly, just some really cool data. John Wallace interviewed here for a position. Very excited about the possibility of that position. This is data that John worked up and shared with me. So what is this? Let's look. Cover crops, you'll see, you're going to see the data splash up in a minute. Different cover crops and their capacity to retain nitrogen and their capacity to suppress weeds that have evolved resistance to the herbicide. So this would be my way of thinking with like the alternative. If it's high, an ideal one would be high up here. High retention, high suppression. Not so good, low suppression, low retention. And the data are really exciting. Study after study. High retention, high suppression. That looks really nice. What are the practices that I was driving through when I was going down to DC? Cereal rye, and forage radish and things. Ecosystem service provisioning, pest suppression, reduction in selection for resistance of plants to herbicides. Fascinating. Multifunctional agriculture. We looked at one axis, reducing resistance selection pressure and N retention. But we can certainly, here's four axes, we could have six or more, whatever number we want to do. It's fun when you do this with farmers, they'll tell you what the axes need to be. Let's talk about the axes and how do we measure them? How do we do this together? More data on, in this case, cover crops. Again, high numbers are high suppression of weeds as a function of some adding some residual fertilizer to the system. Generally bumps up the aggressiveness of the cover crop, reducing weed problems in the field. John went on to take an approach that Bruce Maxwell and Marie Jasniuk and others have taken to looking at this at the population level. And again, the cover crop is having a profound effect on reducing selection and probability of resistance arriving in the fields. Very exciting. Okay. And then I just wanted to turn to the power of citizen science and farmer experimentation with this cover crop case study. And I know you guys here at Cornell are doing some work like this. This is some very interesting work that Ebony Morrell and Charlie White and others at Penn State have been doing, where they're interested in better understanding how our research station results translate onto farmers' fields by taking treatments from the research station and asking the farmer if they would implement the treatment on their farm, and then observing some of the same things we observe at the research station. And so in this case, this was a designed mixture of cover crops that would enhance ecosystem service provisioning that's comprised of red clover, Austrian winter pea, cereal rye, and canola. And you know, it looks like that in the early spring. But let's flash over to the research station result. And so cereal rye is green, canola is purple, pea is blue, and red clover is red. And the wedge is the proportional biomass. So 3/4 of the biomass was comprised of cereal rye, and the other wedges by canola, pea, and red clover. Again, I have a tendency to start repeating myself, but ecosystem service provisioning. We then, Charlie took this to three other farms, and the results looked like this across the farms. Fascinating. We've been working on this for like 6 years. For me, 4 years in, I was fascinated with this result. This was the most fascinating part of the study for me. We had spent 30-acre place-based experiment observing things behaving like this, and then we go to the farmer's place and it observes like this in one farm, this in another farm, and this one in another farm. Local context shapes the dynamics of interplanted competition and And so what we have been doing then with this data, we use this data for justification for a renewal of a proposal entitled Farm Tuning Your Cover Crop Cocktail, which was funded. And we now have these experiments out on about 11 farms, several in southern New York, most of them in Pennsylvania. And we have now hypotheses about what's driving the wedges to turn out the way they are. And we've kind of really are rethinking the way we went into this. We went into this with the idea that, you know, you want to have some proportion of rye and such and such, but we're realizing actually that the way we should be thinking of this is that the individual place should tell you what it needs and then design the mix in response to what the site tells you. High in nitrogen, don't plant legumes or plant very much fewer of them, et cetera. So we're coming up with models now derived from the farmer's data. And this is fascinating. We just had an advisory committee meeting. So here's Ebony. Here's one of the farmers that's working on this project. And then Ebony basically works their data up for them because they're busy. They come into the room, and then they basically tell us what the data mean. And it's fascinating, one after another. Joe says this, Sue says that. Everybody's taking notes. And the learning that's been going on in this farmer-to-farmer exchange, where researchers, in this case, are the facilitator, convener, sharer of the capacity to do something with the data, but then let the farmers do the talking and do the thinking out loud, create space for conversation, and then see how it improves the models. It's been fascinating. And then after lunch, Ebony would show everyone's data. Here's Tor Osher's farm, Dobson, et cetera, and we start working with models on growing degree days, nitrogen availability, et cetera, to see. So Charlie White and Ebony now have a working model that actually will let you dial in, you know, these variables that are going to tell us something about what you probably want in the mix. And then we have been doing this in an iterative way with the farmers. Really exciting. Bright. Pest suppression. Pollinator support. Multifunctional practices. Not single tactics aimed at one weed species or a suite of weed species, as was in the dark midsection. So in summary then, I am really excited about all of us working toward practices where we are not thinking about weed suppression alone, or we're not thinking about insect pest problems alone, but that we're thinking about the suites of things that we're trying to get out of the management and stewardship that we are putting into individual fields and into the management of landscapes. I'm also convinced that we don't know near enough about how we quantify this. And Denise Finney has been working down where we are, has been doing some really cool stuff on the quantitative assessment of multifunctionality, but we got a long ways to go there, I think. One of the things that I've learned in the process of doing the science over 31 years as a faculty member and 8 more as a graduate student, and I learned it really late actually, is that there's a lot of power in challenging misleading, paradigms or misleading statements, misleading claims. And I think that we need to encourage one another to be more active in challenging statements that either don't make ecological sense or make agronomic sense, rather than maybe deciding I'm too busy to do that or something. I think I decided I was too busy or naive for about 20 plus years and kicked into gear about 8 years ago on this. And I think it's been very telling to kind of see how important it is and also realize how little some other folks really know about these things that we all know so much about and need help to understand better in the decision-making frame space. I think it's sometimes the case, that people will dismiss ecologically based things as being kind of, this is just for little agriculture, or this is just for gardeners, or it's just academic. That's another thing you will hear people say. But it's not. The cover cropping thing is real. The farmers are ecologically minded folks that are excited about this, and I think that's really exciting. And then finally, I have been for a while, and I'm increasingly very excited about this facilitation role that we play. I serve on the board for the Pennsylvania Association for Sustainable Ag, and at their conference that usually about 1,800 folks attend, the farmer-to-farmer exchange and their excitement about data collection and sharing data really struck me at the February meeting. So I think there's a lot of space for us to be actively engaged with farmers in this way, and I find that very exciting as a hopeful way of charting pest management practices that are going to be more sustainable going forward. I thank you for your attention.
Thanks a lot. Lots of great topics. Just on the herbicide toxicity, as you say, one of the early arguments was to replace with Roundup, replace some of the more toxic earlier herbicides. So, and that did happen for a while. And it was mismanaged as we documented. But it did reduce overall toxicity, right? So it's not just pounds of herbicide that, that matter. And you got into this later, but I just wanted to kind of highlight that, that one could imagine using such a tool more carefully and avoiding the resistance problems. You know, there could have been another pathway where that could have provided some benefit. You know what I'm getting at? I guess what I'm trying to say is, technologies are technologies, and it's really about how we use them, as opposed to sort of this one's, this whole technology should be all continuing.
So, did everybody hear the question or the comment? Before glyphosate crops came online, the glyphosate was replacing something else, and it was replacing some older herbicides that were problematic from the genotox point of view, as we were looking at example. So it's, it can be misleading just to look at total amount of use. That's a very good point. And the hubris of how we use technology, the wisdom that we approach technology with, should be something that we should be much more thoughtful about. I couldn't agree with more with both of those points. However, I would also, I guess it's my feeling that I haven't seen us be very careful with technology adoption, honestly, in the 30 years that I've watched all of this stuff happen. I think the complicating factor on making wise decisions about technology is that there is this enormous market force pressure. And I saw it, and it's not written up anywhere very often, but I saw it happening in the press, and it was powerful. And what does that market force look like? The market force looks like this. Joe, we'll sell you the seed at full price, the pesticide, you go get the pesticide. Well, all the while, the seed companies are buying the input companies. So that now over 70% of the pesticide inputs and seed companies are one and the same, owned by five companies. The company then says, the company then says, if you buy the herbicide and the seed, I'll give you 20% discount. That's pretty enticing. People are working on the margin, and that looks really good. Then they say, if you buy 100 units, we'll give you the 20% whatever discount. If you buy 1,000 units, we'll give you 35% discount. Lock it. So technology, when we think about technology, and I feel, you know, I think we need to really also understand, and I don't understand it well, not economists, but we need to understand the market technology interplay, because I think in this kind of system, they go hand in hand, they're very difficult to separate. Good point. It's the technology, and we should look at the technology on its merits, and then also look at how the technology can be used. Another question.
Yeah. Just make a comment about what we spoke about. I've seen that with nitrogen products, with inhibitors and controlled disease products that were very heavily marketed at these pharma.
Yeah.
And, it's hard to, they make claims too that
yeah.
are pretty dramatic.
Yeah. 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 Yes.
So,
yes.
So, Nate, you mentioned in cover crops and which is really a great area, and I think it's really important. But what do you see as far as when you move across the country and there's not as high rainfall and you get into systems where get into a debate about, the cover crop is now using the moisture that the crop is supposed to be. What do you see in those situations?
Yeah, so I should, be absolutely clear that I was choosing that as an example. In Nebraska, where you're at the margins of rain-fed agriculture, right in the middle third of the state where I used to work, is the point at which evaporation exceeds or precip is less than average transpiration. You cannot do cover cropping very well there unless you're irrigating, right? Because water is so precious in the system, or at least you have to be really careful. Crop rotation, you go to Iowa or go to eastern Nebraska, and we were discussing this again just this morning, there's this whole movement of the third crop. A two-crop rotation. Can we get a winter crop into a corn soybean rotation as a pest management and multifunctional agricultural solution to things? So I think that there is absolutely no question that the regionality of how some of these things will play out and should play out is highly contingent on where you are in the country. There are reasons why Iowa farmers are at 1.7% of cover crops. If all you're growing is corn and soybean, the window to get the cover crops going in the fall is very small compared to growing silage corn in Pennsylvania when the corn is taken all 6 weeks earlier. So, and where we have winter grains being grown and that kind of thing. Right? So, definitely. And that's all part of thinking about the system in the context of where it's being grown. And I think there, in my view, there, I think this sort of thing. These two books here have a lot of, there's a lot to be learned by getting comfortable in a local space and understanding the constraints the farmers are working with it, and then designing the ecological based approaches that match up with those. Yeah, a good point. Yeah. Yes, Laura?
Well, I'm just wondering if you have ideas about, how we're really going to fundamentally change the agro. Ecological policies at the national level, because it seems like, that's what's really driving the system. The incentives are not well matched with multifunctional agricultural systems. The incentives, the reward yield, are still dominant, and that also impacts the Monsanto. So, I think syndrome is a good way to describe it, because it's all connected, and it's a very tight structure. And, once you get into what's, the really big ag, that's the global market, that's what dominates in the Midwest. There's plenty of rainfall for cover crops there.
Yeah.
but they're dominated by global markets, whereas the situation in Pennsylvania and New York is different. That's why the systems are more diverse.
Yes.
So, you know, it just seems like over and over again, the USDA and the EPA and our government decides to stay on the same track. The most recent decision about, you know,
yeah.
allowing the more problematic yeah. herbicides back into the picture in a big way.
Yes.
You know, it's, I mean, it's been going on for since the 1980s when sustainable agriculture first got on the radar. So,
yeah. Yeah.
I mean, you have ideas about how to change the big, you know, elephant.
Yeah, I have to say that I wish I had maybe more ideas than you. And I'm sure we all have ideas, but here's my idea. I think that one of the things that I've learned on the herbicide resistance business is if you're trying to influence and sway decisions that are being made, you really have to get in early. Or as one administrator told me, the jello is setting. The form is taking place. This room for wiggling there is kind of going away fast, so the window is closing. I think on the herbicide resistance thing, I first spoke about that at the Portland IPM meetings, I think it was 2009. And then we dove into this issue in my lab in like 2009. Prepared to talk, so this was in 2008. By the time I actually was like down in DC talking with people about this, it might have been around the time the 2012 paper came out, and that was too late. You would sit with the Secretary of Agriculture in his office, and he would tell you, Dave, I read your papers last night. They're very interesting. But right after you leave, the corn growers from Iowa, along with Monsanto, and you know, these are coming in with meetings right after you, and they're going to argue exactly the opposite of what you just told me. And what I realized then was that there needs to be a more organized and a more thoughtfully designed plan that you try to gain traction with by getting buy-in from different groups, and that needed to happen well before I got involved with that one. That was one thing I did. I also think that the Farm Bill, I've always like dreaded reading the Farm Bill. Let's read the Farm Bill together. Figure out where is the wiggle room in the Farm Bill. You know, there is actually disincentives in the Farm Bill for cover cropping. So there's some no-brainer things that. And in fact, the most recent Farm Bill has taken steps to remove some of those, but they're not all out. So things, for example, like if you want crop insurance in Midwestern United States for corn, you can't get crop insurance, or you couldn't with cover crops in the field, because there was a perception that the cover crops would affect corn yield, and the insurance companies would be paying farmers for depleted yields of corn that were actually due to a cover cropping practice. Those are things that agroecologists, us in this room, can help set policymakers straight on. And it seems to me a place, Lori, is to start with the no-brainer things like that and say, we need to stop that. That's just doesn't make any sense at all. And then I think the Farm Bill needs also to get more crop rotation in it. And we were talking about the challenges to this in the morning meeting yesterday. It's not trivial because we have all this infrastructure and everything else that's developed around those crops. But I think that's another big one, is that. So, personally, I haven't had a lot of success working through the science societies on this. Like, my views on this weed part of it are outside of the weed science society, so that the science society actually was going the other way.
I know how that feels.
Yeah, so I'm not convinced that that's the way to go forward, unless you have a very open-minded science society that's going to be progressive in the policy point.
I'd just like to kind of follow up on that and ask the question, do you think there's enough alternative science out there in terms of successful alternatives to standard herbicide, pesticide packages that you can actually really make a strong case? because it's good to have the concepts and the ideas and the limited amount of information, but it seems like you have to have a sufficient, do you have a sufficient amount of information to be convincing policymakers or not at this point? I mean, it seems to me that that's the challenge.
And I think on the research outreach community, you have the science that is attractive and you actually do these things to scale. And that's what they ask you to offer up the alternatives. And I think we have some of them. Like, I feel like we have, I think we've got enough that you can argue, you know, that going the heavier duty pesticide route, we've got substitutions for that that actually would work to scale. I feel like we do. Do we need more? We need a lot more. Do we need to understand it better in local, regional, contextual space? I think we need to understand that a lot better than we do. And I do think, again, not to repeat, but I do think that this kind of, you know, getting on the ground with folks that are trying to make this stuff work and listening to them is what's going to inform the right kind of research that will provide those alternatives that are more robust.
I think a big thing that can help in the data is if there was some accountability. So, you know, the USDA used to do a lot more monitoring of pesticide fertilizers and EPA water quality. Mm-hmm. If we could get more of that monitoring data, then we could make intelligent decisions as, you know, like about appropriate technologies and, you know, blending.
Yeah.
So it's a big hole.
Yes.
And it results in this polarization.
Yes.
That's happening.
Yeah. I think that's a very good point. I think that we should be arguing for more data within reason, but more data. Like, definitely don't stop collecting pesticide residue data. You know, this doesn't make any sense. So we should be doing more of that. And then I think we also should be somehow doing more to make that data available to the people that really understand what it might be telling us. Sometimes it winds up getting stuck somewhere where there's some cool analysis that's been done, but it hasn't actually been the full group of folks that really understand what's driving those behaviors on the ground. I think that starts to be very insightful too. Yeah.
And just to maybe try to add to the brightness of bringing up of the farmer to farmer, and the question about, you know, we're always going to be limited with research, right? Research is expensive. But if it's possible to go on farms and do a better job of learning what the most successful farmers are doing, that can be quantified with researchers on farms quantifying that. So that does seem like it's a way to expand the research base and also give that political, this is what a real farmer is really doing, and we measured it. That would seem like that has some power beyond the research base.
Definitely.
And,
yes.
You know, for me, it's been interesting just to look at when people have collected good enterprise budgets from farms, you know, to really see what are the farmers that are making more profit doing. I think we could apply that kind of budgeting approach to, you know, inputs, outputs on a more eco-ag framework.
I think that's a really good idea. And we certainly have a lot more of that kind of data coming in than we did 10 years ago, all across the farming spectrum. So I think that's a great point.
I guess we're really pushing time here, so let's thank David.
This has been a production of Cornell University, on the web at cornell.edu.